Hello, this is Keith Miller again, and in this video I'm going to take a brief look at faulting, looking at the characteristics of different faults, how you describe different types of faults, terminology that is used, and also the different types of forces that are generating different types of faults. So I have here a model shows the colors represent different rock layers, and I can move these two blocks relative to each other. And so if I move this, well, first off, here's the fault. This inclined surface is the fault surface, and you can use strike and dip to describe the orientation of that fault surface. And the block of rock that sits on top of the fault is called the headwall block. And the block below the fault is called the footwall block. Now, if the headwall block falls down relative to the footwall block, that is called a normal fault. Okay? So this is called a normal fault. And what you see is a couple things. Not only is this block gone down relative to that, so you can match the beds across the fault and see that this block has gone down relative to this one, but it's also moved away from the other block. And that is because to form a normal fault, you have to pull it apart. So this requires a tensional force, tensional stress, pulling the crust apart, stretching it. And that's what generates normal faulting, which results in these rocks taking up less or taking up more horizontal space. On the other hand, if I take this block, take the headwall block, and I raise it up relative to the footwall block, that is called a reverse fault, that it is reversed from a normal fault. And so now these beds are raised up above this one. So if you cut this surface off, the layers on this side are going to be older than the beds over here. So on a map view, in a reverse fault, the beds on the headwall side are going to be older than the footwall block. Because this block has gone up, you row the younger beds off, it exposes older beds underneath. Similarly, or oppositely, in a normal fault, if you rode this portion off, these beds exposed at the surface here on the footwall block are going to be younger than the beds at the same level. Also, in order to get a reverse fault, I have to push these two blocks together. So this requires forces that are compressing the rock. So this is a compressional stress, while the other is tensional stress. There's one other way that these two blocks can move relative to each other, and that is side to side. So notice I'm not moving the one block higher than the other, I'm simply moving side to side. And that's called a strike-slip fault, because the strike of this fault plane is the direction in which the two blocks are moving. They're moving parallel to the strikes, that makes them a strike slip fault. The other two faults that I looked at are called dip slip faults because they're moving parallel to the dip of the fault plane. And this requires a shearing stress, like a scissors. A shearing stress in order to move one block sideways relative to the other. Now, oftentimes with normal faults occur in bunches. Very unusual to have a single fault. They occur in a whole series. And in places where the crust is being stretched, so you can pull it apart, you end up with a landscape that looks like this, with certain blocks that are raised up and then certain blocks that are dropped down. Again, the head wall blocks drop down and the foot wall blocks raised up. And that is a result of the area being pulled apart. And these are called horse and grobbins. The uplifted blocks are called horse, and the down drop blocks are called grobbins. And that's a very typical topography in a place where the crust is being stretched. So now we've looked at both faulting and folding, and your next step will now be to recognize these structures in maps and cross sections.